Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Gandharvika Giridhari, Gandharvika Giridhari Radhe. Jai Gauranitai Jaya, Gauranitai Jaya. Gauranitai Jaya Gauranitai Jai Lakshmi Narasimha Jaya Ananta Dev Jaya Lakshmi Narasimha Jaya Ananta Dev Jaya Jaya Prabhupad Prabhupad Prabhupada Jaya Jaya Prabhupada Nitai Gaura Haribol 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 Nitai Gaura Haribol
Paramhansa Parivrajaka Acharya Stotra Sata. His Divine Grace Abhay Charanaravinda Bhakti Vedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai. Sriman Mahaprabhu Sri Gandharvika Giridhari Ki Jai. Sri Prahlad Narasimha Dev Ki Jai. Sri Lakshmi Narasimha Dev Ananta Dev Ki Jai. Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai. Nitai Gaura Premanande. All glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to the assembled devotees, all glories, all glories, all glories to Sri Guru and Gauranga. Till what time is the class?
10 o'clock.
Today's a working day, so people can stay. Till what time?
We can go till 9:30.
It
was announced as 8:15
to 9:30. Okay. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Narayanam Namaskritya. Naram Chaiva Narottamam. Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam. Tato Jaya Mudirayet Nashta Prayeshva Bhadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavatyuttama shloke Bhaktir bhavati naishthiki. I was requested to speak on the prayers of Lord Brahma to Lord Krishna. This is in the 14th chapter of the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So we'll begin with the first verse of that chapter. First verse. I want the first verse to be put. Okay, we'll chant later. You can erase it and put the first one. Meanwhile, I'll discuss other things. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kada Mahyam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yutapadakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sakrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhan Vitamscha Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swamin Nitinamine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare 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 Krishna. Hare Krishna. I am very happy to be back again in Sri Narasimha Giridhari temple after 1 year. It is usually at the time of the Narasimha Chaturdashi festival that I am here, and I have the good fortune and opportunity to be here again in this wonderful temple amongst all of you this year as well. As I mentioned, I was requested to speak on the prayers of Lord Brahma to Lord Krishna, which appears in the 14th chapter of the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And before we actually begin discussion on these prayers, a brief background would be helpful. A background about the importance of offering prayers, firstly. And secondly, about what the circumstances were that caused Lord Brahma to offer these beautiful prayers to Lord Krishna. In the 7th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, the great devotee Prahlad also offers many wonderful prayers to Lord Krishna. In the course of Prahlad's teachings and his utterances, he speaks this very well-known verse, which I'm sure all of us are aware of. Shravanam Kirtanam Vishnu Smaranam Padasevanam Archanam Vandanam Dasyam Sakhyam Atmanivedanam Iti Punsar Pita Vishnu Bhaktis Chinnavalakshana Kriyeta Bhagavatyadha Tanmanyedhi Tamuttamam. Prahlad Maharaj gives us a definition of who the most learned person in the world is. A learned person is not necessarily one who only has some degrees from a university or a college, or not even necessarily one who is a Sanskrit scholar, or who has got lots of prizes and other such acknowledgements from the world at large. Adhita means learned. Uttamam means the best. So best amongst the learned persons is one, Kriyeta Bhagavati Adha, who has completely accepted directly the process of devotional service as described by Prahlad, the ninefold devotional process. Bhaktis chen navalakshana iti punsarpita Vishnu. So one who accepts this ninefold process of bhakti, of devotional service to Lord Krishna, is the most learned person. And the ninefold process, of course, is Shravanam, Kirtanam, Smaranam, etc. And we are all familiar with these nine processes. Amongst these nine processes, the sixth one is Vandanam. Vandanam means to offer prayers. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, in his comments to this verse, he refers to the Bhagavad Gita verse, Manmana Bhavamad Bhakto Madhyaji Mam Namaskuru Mam Evaishasi Yuktvaivam Atmanam Parayanaha, where Lord Krishna says that one should become his devotee, one should always think of him, one should worship him, and one should offer namaskar to him. Mam namaskuru. Namaskuru means to offer obeisances. So Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur says that vandanam means to offer obeisances and to offer prayers. Generally, when we think of vandanam, we only think of offering prayers. But Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur says, even the offering of respectful obeisances to the Lord is part of the process of Vandanam. And Srila Prabhupada also, in his purports, he mentions this comment of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta. And later on, he goes on to also explain the process of Vandanam. He mentions that when the devotee understands and appreciates the glories, the qualities, and the opulences of the Supreme Lord, he begins to appreciate them so much that these glories, qualities, and opulences influence his or her mind. Then, under that influence, he or she speaks words of glorification for the Lord. And such offerings, heartfelt offerings, are called vandanam or prayers. And because they are offered in such a respectful mood, in such a devotional mood, they are usually accompanied either with physical offering of obeisances or at least offering of obeisances in the heart. Therefore, vandanam combines the offering of obeisances with the offering of verbal or mental prayers. Prayers are offered with the mind, with the words, and also with the body, like are all aspects of devotional service. And Srila Prabhupada mentions in the purport there also that there are certain offenses to be avoided in the offering of obeisances to the Lord. For example, one should not offer obeisances on one hand. Many times we see the devotees offering obeisances, holding the tulsi, the bead bag in one hand under their chest, and with one hand they offer obeisances. That is Hitler's obeisance, with one hand like that. But for the Lord, we offer with both hands. That's called full pranam, dandavat pranam, shashtanga pranam.
Mataji's will of course offer what is called a panchanga pranam. They will not lie down on fully on the floor with hands outstretched, but they will bow down and offer panchanga pranam. Prabhupada also mentions that the offering of obeisances with one's body covered is also an offense. Also, it is an offense to offer obeisances from very near to the Lord, to the deity. So if one is on the altar, for example, one should not offer obeisances when one is on the altar or one is about to offer or has finished offering arati. One should offer obeisances at a distance from the Lord, not very close to the Lord. Also, one should not sit with one's back to the Lord. Also, one should not offer obeisances from the left side of the Lord. So these are some things that Srila Prabhupada mentions in his purports in connection to Vandanam, prayers. There are, of course, many, many famous prayers of celebrated devotees of the Lord. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, we have the prayers, for example, of Bhishma, the prayers of Queen Kunti, the prayers of Muchukunda, the prayers of Prahlad, and many, many such other wonderful prayers. And amongst them, and noteworthy, are the prayers of Lord Brahma that he has offered here. Of course, not included in the Srimad Bhagavatam, but celebrated also, are prayers like the Brahma Samhita, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Shikshashtakam prayers, and many, many, many other such wonderful prayers offered by exalted devotees of the Lord. So the process of Vandanam is important. It's one of the nine processes. And inasmuch as we are trying to be pure devotees of the Lord, we must understand what these nine processes are, and we must also try to practice them. So we practice them by learning from how great devotees have done these things in the past and are also doing it at present. So by reading and hearing about the prayers offered by these great devotees, we also understand how to offer prayers. We also understand what the proper mood should be, what the content of the prayer should be, what we should pray for, what we should not pray for. Because you see, the process of bhakti is also a science. It is very deep, very intricate. And therefore, we must understand very properly the consciousness in which these prayers have to be offered, the purpose for which prayers have to be offered, and what the prayers actually should consist of. Generally, it is the practice of people in the world, those amongst them, that is, who go to places of worship or who believe in God and prayer, they offer prayers often for some material purpose, either because they are in some difficulty and they want relief from that difficulty, or because they are seeking something material from the Lord, like wealth or prestige or name or fame or something like that. But the prayers that Prahlad speaks about in Vandanam, they are not these sort of prayers. They are prayers that are offered with a pure heart, or at least with a heart that is desiring to be pure, in a heart that does not seek selfishly something from the Supreme Lord on the material platform, a heart that only seeks to offer love and with a desire to please the Supreme Personality of Godhead. This is genuine Vandanam. And these wonderful prayers, some of which I have mentioned now, they teach us how to pray in this mood. So let us now come to the background of Lord Brahma's offering these prayers. An extraordinary event. Lord Krishna in Vrindavan had, as was his daily custom, was taking out the cowherd boys and the calves into the forest. He was at that time about 5 years old. When the calves and the cowherd boys were in the forest, the calves would graze on the very green grass, luscious grass everywhere. The cowherd boys would gather together and they would frolic and have wonderful games together. They would enjoy themselves thoroughly. On this particular day, it so happened, also by the way, this was the birthday of Lord Balaram. So Balaram was not present there because his mother Rohini had kept him back at home for performing so many celebrations and prayers and worship and so on. So on this occasion, when Krishna was busy playing with his cowherd boys, friends, the calves strayed away into the forest. At this time, Krishna was having a picnic and they were eating all sorts of things which their mothers had packed for them in their tiffin boxes. They were small boys of only 5 years old. And such was the intimate exchange of love between the cowherd boys and Krishna that it was completely astonishing. Astonishing not just to ordinary people who may have seen it, but even to the creator of the world, Brahma. Brahma had never quite seen anything like this. Brahma had been accustomed to the opulent worship of the Lord in a mood of awe and reverence. He had never seen worship or dealings with the Lord with such intimacy, where there was such a degree of familiarity with the Lord. You see, as Krishna was sitting with his cowherd boys and each of them had the prasadam or the food that had been sent to them by their parents, they were stealing from each other's tiffin boxes. As little boys are wont to do, they play mischief with each other. If there's one little boy who has his tiffin, one boy would steal something, or he would steal the whole box, and this boy would lunge after the box and this other boy would pass it down, and the tiffin box would circulate and this boy would run after everybody to retrieve his tiffin box. Sometimes Krishna's box would be stolen. Sometimes they would pick up something from Krishna's box and Krishna would run after it, just like ordinary little boys play. And even things like when Krishna had his mouth full of buttermilk, another boy would go and poke his fingers in his cheeks so that the buttermilk would come out. And these kind of pastimes were happening there. And Krishna was eating not all the opulent grand foodstuffs that kings and big lords are accustomed to having, but he was eating, and that too in his left hand, not even in his right hand. Cultured people eat with their right hand, they don't eat with their left hand. But children, they eat with both hands, they eat anywhere. So Krishna had some rice mixed with yogurt and some fruit, curd rice with fruit, in his left hand. And Brahma was watching all this. And Brahma was really perplexed. What is going on here? I thought that this is Lord Hari. But is this really Lord Hari? So he's thinking and thinking, he's perplexed. In the Garga Samhita, there's a very beautiful description of this condition of Brahma. Drishovacha Krishnam Manasacha Uchu. So looking at Krishna like this, Brahma Uchu is speaking Manasa in his own mind. Tvayamcha gopa nahi deva devaha. Tu ayam, this is a gopa, is a cowherd boy, merely a cowherd boy. Nacha deva devaha, he is not the lord of lords, Hari, or this cannot be him. Why can it not be him? Harir yadi syat bahu kutsat anne katham ratova varja gopa balakaihi. Harir yadi syat, if this is really Lord Hari, then why is he enjoying katham ratova,
Rato, rati means to enjoy. Katha means why or how.
How is it that if this is really Hari, he is enjoying kutsita anna, the wretched food, ordinary food that poor folk eat. How is it that he is eating this kind of foodstuffs?
And Vrajagopalakaihi, with the cowherd boys of Vrindavan, sitting here on the bank of the Yamuna in Vrindavan.
So the doubt arose in Lord Brahma's mind. Is this really Lord Hari? Lord Hari should be having foodstuffs that are grand in all the temples. He's offered what we call chappan bhog, 56 times a day. He's offered grand foodstuffs, and on each occasion there are hundreds of delicacies offered, the choicest of delicacies. And here he is eating this ordinary food, curd rice with some little fruit maybe, and that too with the left hand. So is this really the Lord? So Brahma knew it, but still that doubt was there. So he wanted to examine whether this is really the Lord. And in his heart of heart, of course, he knew that this is the Lord. So he wanted to glorify the Lord as well. He wanted to do something which would induce the Lord to exhibit at least a small portion of his potency, so that everyone could understand his glories. He wanted to examine the potency of the Lord. So then he descended on his swan carrier, the Hansa Vahana. And when Krishna had gone into the forest to retrieve the calves, at that time Brahma descended. What had happened was that upon not seeing the calves in the vicinity, the cowherd boys had become anxious. Where are our calves? Where have they gone? So Krishna saw them in anxiety. He said, don't worry, eat your prasadam, eat your food peacefully. Be at ease. You see, Ayurveda also says that when you eat your food, you should be peaceful. You should be in a good mood. The one who cooks should also be in a good mood. The one who serves should be in a good mood. The one who eats also should be in a good mood. If you are very angry or upset about something, don't eat at that time. Wait for some time till you have cooled down. Better to chant Hare Krishna for some time, cool down, and then eat. So Lord Krishna did not want his cowherd boyfriends to be in anxiety at all, and especially when eating. So he said, don't worry, my dear friends, you take your meals. I'll come back, I'll go and search for the cows and I'll bring them back. So Krishna went into the forest. And the cowherd boys meanwhile continued to eat. At that time Brahma descended. And he said, let me test whether this is actually Krishna or not. So by his mystic power, and Lord Brahma has enormous mystic power. After all, he is the creator of the universe. You cannot create the universe if you don't have such kind of power. So he hid the calves and the cowherd boys in a cave, and he closed the mouth of the cave. And then he was thinking, now let me see the fun. So he hid the calves and the cowherd boys, and he returned to Brahmaloka. For Lord Brahma to return to Brahmaloka or to come from there to the earth doesn't take long. He can come in a moment. So in any case, Lord Krishna came back. He still had his curd rice and fruit on the left hand. And he was thinking, what has happened? Where are my calves gone? He's acting like an ordinary cowherd boy. This is called pastime. It's called Leela. In one place, Srila Prabhupada explains very nicely what is the meaning of the word Leela. When the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the source of everything, the ultimate controller of everything, thinks of himself as a cowherd boy, this is called pastime. Leela. And because this is eternal, Lord Krishna eternally thinks of himself as a cowherd boy. So this Leela is also the truth it is also eternal. So to say that Lord Krishna is a cowherd boy is not false, because he is eternally like that, as a cowherd boy in Goloka Vrindavan. So Lord Krishna acting as a cowherd boy, innocent, small boy, 5 years old, acting bewildered. What happened? Where have my friends gone all of a sudden? Where are the calves gone? Then he comes back in his mood of Bhagavan. Ah, Brahma has stolen them and Brahma has hidden them in the cave. Okay. So if Brahma wants to exhibit his tiny mystic power, let me also exhibit a tiny fraction of my mystic power. After all, if I go back alone, what will all the elder gopis say, who are the mothers of my friends? They will say, Krishna, where are your friends? Where are our sons? And what will I reply to them? And then when I go back without the calves, all the mothers of these calves, the cows, they are anxiously waiting for their progeny to return. And when the calves don't come back, the cows will look at me with forlorn eyes. Krishna, what have you done to our calves? You have not been able to protect them. Where are they? So Krishna was thinking, how can I face the older gopis and the cows? And also, how will the activities go on? I must also take this opportunity to show my mercy to Lord Brahma. And I will also take this opportunity to exhibit a tiny fraction of my glories and my potency to the world at large. So Lord Krishna effortlessly expanded himself into all the cows, the calves rather, and all the cowherd boys. He expanded himself into exact duplicates of all of them, not just in terms of physical appearance, but also in terms of mannerisms, in terms of the way they spoke, etc. They were identical in every respect. Nobody could make out the difference, not even their mothers. You see, when a child is there, someone else may get fooled, but a mother can never get fooled about the identity of the child. But in this case, so perfect was the act of impersonation by Krishna that even their mothers could not understand. So Lord Krishna went back with his expansions, the calves and the cowherd boys, to Vrindavan. And in the village, nobody could understand that these were not their sons. So the older gopis thought that our sons have come back. The cows thought our calves have come back. And they all embraced them and they loved them, welcomed them back home from the forest. But there was one difference. Does anyone know what was that one difference that happened? What was that one difference that took place? Huh? Yes. You see, in Vrindavan, there is one peculiar feature that is never found anywhere. Always, parents love their children more than they love other children. Everybody loves children, but parents will love their own children more than other children. Yes, this is the fact of this world. But in Vrindavan, it was not so. In Vrindavan, the gopis and the gopas, they loved Krishna more than their own children. So this is a test for all of you who are grihasthas. If you want to follow in the footsteps of the Vrajavasis, you have to also learn to love Krishna more than your own children. You want to become pure devotees. Not that you should not love your children, of course. But you should learn to love Krishna more than them. So in Vrindavan, the Vrajabasis loved Krishna more than their own children. But on this day, they felt a love for their own children that was so great, that was equal to Krishna. And they could not understand why. Why is it that on this day we are experiencing a love for our children that is equal to our love for Krishna? They could not understand this point. Anyway, this went on for one full year, which is like one moment of Brahma's time. Time is relative in this world. So Brahma, meanwhile, after a moment of his time had passed, he thought, let me go back and see the fun now. And Srila Prabhupada comments in the Krishna book that while he did have this feeling that he wanted to see the fun, there was also some anxiety in Krishna's mind. What was that anxiety? Or rather, in Brahma's mind, that anxiety was, I am playing with fire. So I don't know what is going to be the consequence of this. What would be the result? So Brahma came on his swan carrier. He came to Vrindavan and he went to the cave. Before he went to the cave, he saw that Krishna was there with the cowherd boys and the calves, as was the situation 1 year earlier. Of course, the calves and the cowherd boys had grown in 1 year, because at the age of 5, you grow very fast. So between the ages of 5 and 6, these calves and the cowherd boys had grown. But they were still the same calves and the same cowherd boys. So Brahma was perplexed. How come? I have hidden all of them very safely, very securely in that cave. How come Krishna is here with these very same cowherd boys and the calves? Has he in some way retrieved them from the cave? Let me go and see what's in the cave. So he went immediately to the cave, opened it, and saw that these cowherd boys and the calves are still in mystic slumber. They're still lying inside the cave. So he said, very strange. So he went back to where Krishna was and he saw again the cowherd boys and the calves. He came back to the cave. He again saw the same ones. And his forehead started spinning. So better we have only one head. When one head spins, we have enough problems. So Brahma's foreheads were spinning. What am I seeing? The cowherd boys and the calves are in two places at the same time. Is Krishna playing some trick on me that every time I go to one place, before I reach there, he has transferred them to this place? And when I go to the cave again, before I reach the cave, he has transferred the cowherd boys and the calves before I reach the cave? No, no, no. Because I'm going pretty fast as well. So how is it that the same cowherd boys and the calves are at two places at the same time? Which are the real calves and the cowherd boys? These seem like the real cowherd boys, but when I go to the cave, I feel those are the real cowherd boys. And Brahma was stunned in bewilderment. He did not know what to do, what to say. He did not understand what was happening. And in that state of bewilderment and being stunned, Krishna revealed to him something extraordinary, something majestic. All these cowherd boys and calves who were actually expansions of Krishna now assumed four-armed forms of Lord Narayan. And each of them, and there were thousands and thousands of calves and cowherd boys, so in front of his eyes, even as he was seated on his swan carrier, Brahma saw thousands and thousands of Narayana forms, each with four hands. And he was struck with wonder. What is going on here? All of these are actually Narayan, the Supreme Lord. This is indeed Lord Hari, this little boy. Fie upon me that I doubted his. He had mixed feelings about whether this is Hari or not. But now it was established with certainty that this is indeed Lord Hari. And he felt himself so insignificant, so tiny. And he started becoming nervous and afraid. What have I done? I have committed a great offense against the Supreme Personality of Godhead. I was so foolish that I dared to think that I could exhibit my mystic potency to test the Supreme Lord. But actually, the only result of my exhibiting my mystic potency is that I have got completely bewildered and stunned. And Lord Brahma, as he will explain in his prayers later, felt himself like a firefly in the bright noontime sun. The firefly seems to be very attractive only at night. But when the sunshine is bright at noon, nobody can even notice the firefly. So Brahma was thinking, what is the value of my mystic potency? I became so proud and puffed up thinking, I am very powerful. I have so much potency. I dared to think I could test Krishna. And Krishna has exhibited just a very atomic fraction of his mystic power. And look how he has bewildered me thoroughly. At that time, Brahma came back to his external consciousness and he saw Vrindavan again. And he saw this little boy Krishna. You know, in his left hand, this little boy had curd rice with some little pieces of fruit. And he was standing there looking. Oh, where are my cowherd boyfriends? Where are the calves? What is happening? And Brahma got down from his swan carrier. And he prostrated himself fully, offered his dandavat pranam. And with all his four heads, his four crowns, touching the lotus feet of Krishna, he began to cry tears of repentance and ecstasy at the same time. In his mind, he was feeling repentance because he had dared to do what he did. And at the same time, he was also thinking, even though I have committed such an offensive act, but my dear Lord, you are very kind and merciful. And your nature is to forgive the ignorant. So even though Brahma is the most learned person in the whole universe, the most intelligent person, his body is made of practically pure intelligence. Amongst the eight elements of material nature, Ashtadha Prakriti, Bhumi, Apanal, Vayu, etc. Our bodies are made of earth, water, fire, air, etc. Brahma's body is practically made of pure intelligence, so subtle. Brahma is so intelligent, so knowledgeable, so scholarly. But yet he thinks, I am completely ignorant. But because it is the nature of the Lord to be very forgiving to ignorant people, that is my only hope. My dear Lord, please forgive my ignorance. Please forgive my impudence that I have dared to come and test you like this. And at that time when he's offering obeisances, he's also ecstatic because he has witnessed the opulence of the Lord. And he has understood, he has witnessed with his own eyes, as they say, a glorious demonstration of a tiny fraction of the Lord's glories. He also saw the beauty and the sweetness of Lord Krishna's pastimes in Vrindavan with his cowherd boys. So he bathed Lord Krishna's lotus feet with his tears. And then he looked up and saw the lotus feet of Krishna. And then again he stood up and he bowed his head down low and began offering these prayers. So the description of this pastime, which is well known among devotee circles as the Brahma Vimohana Leela, is described in the 13th chapter of the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Vimohana means bewilderment. So it is a pastime in which the creator of the world, Brahma, was completely bewildered. Brahma Vimohana Leela. And in the next chapter, that is this 14th chapter, Brahma now starts offering heartfelt prayers to Lord Krishna. In the 14th chapter, there are many verses, but the prayers of Lord Brahma constitute about 40 verses. Naturally, today, tomorrow and day after, in three sessions, it will not be possible for us to describe or recite each of these 40 verses because time does not permit that. And also we have spent quite a bit of time giving an introduction to these prayers. So I will select a few important verses from these prayers. We will recite these important verses, and for the other verse, and we'll discuss them at some length. And then the other verses I will just briefly mention as we go along in this narration. So let us speak about the first verse. Let us recite this. The first verse of the prayers of Lord Brahma in the 14th chapter, in which Brahma is struck with the beauty of Lord Krishna's divine form. So let us recite this verse. Ideally, we would like to recite each word and the word-for-word meaning, etc. But because we have many verses to commit, I will skip the word-for-word meaning. We'll just recite the word and then we'll discuss that. So text 1 of Canto 10, Chapter 14. Shri Brahmovacha. Naumi dyate brava pushe tadidambaraya. Gunjavatam saparipichala sanmukhaya. Vanyasraje kavala vetra vishana venu. Lakshma Shriye Mridupade Pashupanga Jaya. Two from the Prabhu's side, two from the Mataji's side. Please recite this verse. Vibrahmo Vacha. Naumi Dyate Bhrava Pushe Tadidambaraya. Gunjavatam saparipichala sanmukhaya. Vanya sraje kavala vetra vishana venu. Lakshma shriye mridupade pashupanga jaya. Shri Brahmo vacha. Naumi dyate brava pushe tadidambaraya. Gunjavatam saparipichala sanmukhaya. Vanya sraje kavala vetra vishana venu. Lakshma shriye mridupade pashupanga jaya. Mataji's side. Okay, translation. Lord Brahma said, my dear Lord, you are the only worshipable Lord, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and therefore I offer my humble obeisances and prayers just to please you. O son of the king of cowherds, your transcendental body is dark blue like a new cloud. Your garment is brilliant like lightning, and the beauty of your face is enhanced by your gunja earrings and the peacock feather on your head. Wearing garlands of various forest flowers and leaves, and equipped with a herding stick, a buffalo horn, and a flute, you stand beautifully with a morsel of food in your hand. Very beautiful description of Krishna's beauty. Know me, I offer praise. Brahma begins his prayers by offering his praise. Know me, I offer my respects, my obeisances unto whom? Idya. Idya refers to the most worshipable one. So Brahma has realized that Krishna is his most worshipable Lord. Te unto you. Abhra vapushe. Abhra refers to a dark cloud. Vapushe means whose body. So Krishna's body is of the color of a dark blue monsoon cloud. Tadit ambaraya. Tadit ambara. Tadit refers to the dress or the clothes, or rather it refers to lightning. Ambara refers to the dress. So tadit ambara means his dress is of the color of lightning, golden colored. Therefore Krishna's dhoti is called a pitambara also. Sometimes Krishna is also called a pitambara, one who wears the pitambara. Gunja avatamsa. Gunja is a kind of berry that is very dear to Srimati Radharani also. And Krishna wears this. Gunja avatamsa. So he's wearing earrings that are made of the gunja berries. And therefore the beauty of Krishna's face is enhanced by these gunja earrings. And also paripiccha. Paripiccha refers to peacock feathers. He wears a peacock feather in his crown, in his head. Lasan mukhaya. Lasan means resplendent, very bright. So Krishna's face in any way is extremely beautiful, very bright and lovely. And this loveliness and beauty of Krishna's face has been enhanced by these gunja earrings and the peacock feather on his head. Vanya sraje kavala vetra vishana venu. So vanya sraje, vanya means of the forest, sraje means garland. So he's wearing a garland made of forest flowers and leaves and so on. Also he has kavala. Kavala means he has the little yogurt and curd and fruit in his little hand. Vetra vishana venu. Vetra refers to the cowherding stick. Vishana refers to the buffalo horn, and the venu to his flute. So the acharyas explained that as Brahma was offering these prayers, Krishna was standing there with the yogurt and fruit and rice in his left hand and his buffalo horn and cowherding stick tucked under his left armpit and the flute tucked into the belt around his waist. And he's looking here and there, where are my friends, where are my cows? And Brahma is offering these beautiful prayers as he looks on. Lakshma shriye mridupade pashupangajaya. So in this way, he is characterized by these beautiful features. Pashupa angajaya. Pashu means the cows here. Pa means the protector. Referring to Nanda Maharaj, the cowherd boy. Angaja. Angaja means one who is born from his body. Referring to his son. So Krishna is Pashupangaja. Pashupangaja. Which means he is a son of the protector of the cows. That means Nanda Maharaj. So this is a beautiful description by Brahma here. At the very outset he glorifies Krishna's beauty. Krishna's beauty is of course one of his most important qualities which endear and captivate the hearts of all. Whoever comes in contact with Krishna. There are many, many verses in the Srimad Bhagavatam that glorify Krishna's beautiful form. And you will have noticed that there are certain features that are invariably mentioned when Krishna's beautiful form is being described. One of them is the complexion of his body, which is the complexion of a dark monsoon cloud. Second is the peacock feather that he wears in his head. Third is the flute. So these are some features, and amongst others, which are invariably mentioned when the beauty of Krishna is being described. There is this famous song
Geet Govinda by Jayadev Goswami, which actually contains many, many songs within it. The famous Dashavatara Stotra, we sing a portion of that for Lord Narasimha Dev every day. That is also from Geeta Govinda. And in one of these songs, which is called the Ujjvala Geetam, Jayadev Goswami has sung about the beautiful complexion and the beauty of Krishna. Abhinava Jaladhara Sundarahe Dhritamandaraye Dhritamandara Shrimukha Chandra Chakora Jaya Jaya Deva Hare Jaya Jaya Deva Hare. Jayadev Goswami says, Abhinava Jaladhara Sundarahe. Very beautiful description. Abhinava means very new, freshly formed. Jaladhara. Jala is water, dharam is that which holds. A poetic way of saying a cloud. Abhinava Jaladhara Sundarahe. So Lord Krishna's beauty or his complexion is like that of a freshly formed water-bearing cloud. There are clouds often at other times also, but those clouds don't bear water. It is only in the monsoon time that the clouds bear water. So they are called Jaladhara. And here also the word is, where is that? It is not mentioned here. Yeah, te abhra, like a dark cloud. Abhra vapushe, like a dark cloud. So Krishna's complexion is like that, not just of an ordinary cloud, but a water-bearing cloud of the monsoon season. And not just an ordinary water-bearing cloud, but a freshly formed monsoon cloud. Abhinava Jaladhara Sundarahe. Dhrita Mandarahe. Dhrita means to hold. Mandara means the mountain, the Govardhana. So the reference here is to Krishna lifting the Govardhana hill. Shri Mukha Chandra Chakora. Shri referring to Srimati Radharani. And Srimati Radharani is like the Chakora bird that looks at the moon. There are many birds that are described in devotional literature in Sanskrit. The Chakor is one amongst them. The peculiar feature of the Chakor is that the Chakor bird is always looking on in a forlorn way at the moon. He gazes at the moon constantly. So much so that even as the moon rises, he stands at one place and his gaze is fixed on the moon. And as the moon rises in the sky, his feet, the Chakor's feet don't move. Only the neck moves. And the gaze is up higher, 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 higher. When the moon comes right up at the highest point, at his zenith, still he doesn't shift his feet. And when the moon moves behind, he just turns his head behind. And the neck goes backwards and backwards all the way till the moon sets in the opposite horizon. But not for a moment does the Chakor lose sight of the beauty of the moon. The Chakor is so struck by the beauty of the moon that he just keeps on gazing, gazing for all the 12 hours that the moon is above the horizon. From the time it rises till the time it sets. So often in literature, sometimes even in non-devotional literature, it is used to indicate unrequited love. So Srimati Radharani, who is Shri, is gazing at the Mukha Chandra. Srimati Radharani is like the Chakora bird, who is gazing at the moon-like face of Lord Krishna. She doesn't like to remove her sight, her gaze from the beautiful face of Krishna. And it is interesting that Jayadev Goswami mentions Dhrita Mandara. During the Govardhan Leela, when Lord Krishna had lifted the Govardhan mountain on the tip of his little finger of his left hand, all the Brajabasis had the great fortune of experiencing something
that they earlier never had the opportunity to do. What was that? They were able to gaze upon the beautiful face of Krishna 24/7, literally, for 7 days and 24 hours. In normal circumstances, what would happen is they would see Krishna only in the morning and in the evening. When he was about to leave for the forest with the cows and accompanied by his friends, the cowherd boys, and when they were returning from the forest. So only for a short time they were able to gaze at the beautiful form of Krishna. But now, for 24 hours, as Krishna was standing with a very pleasing countenance, with a slight smile on his face, very pleasing smile, he was there holding the Govardhan hill, and all the Brajabasis, the older gopis, the younger gopis, the older gopas, the cowherd boys, the young, everyone, including the cows and everybody, was gazing at Krishna's beautiful face, especially like they were all chakors, because now they had the opportunity to look at Krishna's beautiful face non-stop, without any impediment, without Krishna having to go anywhere here or there. Krishna couldn't go because he was holding the Govardhan. He couldn't leave the Govardhan and go anywhere else. So they were all like that, gazing at his Krishna, at his beautiful face, which was Abhinava Jaladhara Sundara. Hey, very beautiful form of Krishna. Brahma has also glorified Krishna like this. And we've all heard this in the Brahma Samhita. And we can all chant this verse together.
Venum kvanantam aravinda dalaya taksham barhavatam samasitam buddha sundarangam kandarpa kotikamaniya vishesha shobham govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami.
Venum kvanantam. He is playing on the flute. Kvanantam indicates not just that he is playing, but he is actually very adept, very expert in playing the flute.
Venum kvanantam. Aravinda dalat.
Aravinda dala means lotus petals. What are like lotus petals? Aksham, his eyes. And his eyes are blossomed. Ayata. So Aravinda Dala Ayata Aksham. So Venum Kvanantam Aravinda Dalayata Aksham. So Krishna is described as playing the flute, and his eyes, which are like lotus petals, are blossomed, have blooming. Very beautiful description of Lord Krishna.
Barha Avatamsa.
Barha means the peacock feather. Avatamsa means it's an ornament on his head.
Barhavatamsam asita ambuda.
Asita means, one of the meanings of the word is dark. Ambuda means cloud. Again, ambu means water, da means that which gives. So another poetic word for the cloud.
So asita ambuda sundarangam, that his body is very beautiful and his complexion is like that of a monsoon cloud that bears water.
Vishesha shobham. His body is exceptionally lovely. And that loveliness, kamaniya, charms, kandarpa koti, millions of cupids of kamadevas. Such is the beauty of Krishna as is envisaged by Brahma when he speaks his Brahma Samhita prayers. So now we have run out of time. So we will describe Krishna's beauty and the other verses following. This particular verse in Brahma's prayers tomorrow and day after, 8:15. Thank you very much. Shri Gandharvika Giridhari Shriman Mahaprabhu Ki Jai, Grantharaj Shrimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai, Shri Vrindavan Dham Ki Jai, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai, Nitai Gaura Premanande, Hare Krishna.